Hey, what's up, guys? Sorry for the hibernation, but I'm back with another video on cranial nerves. Remember, please hit like and subscribe if you're keen on anything related to the brain. Let's get started. For those neuroscience cookies out there, how many cranial nerves are there? You're spot on if you said 12. But to be technically correct, there are 12 pairs of cranial nerves. Let's take a moment to label them here. Cranial nerve 1 is the olfactory nerve. 2, the optic nerve. Number 3, the oculomotor. 4, trochlear. 5, the almighty trigeminal. 6 is the abducens. 7, the facial nerve. 8, the vestibular cochlea. 9, glossopharyngeal. 10, the vagus nerve. Number 11, the spinal accessory. And finally, number 12, the hypoglossal nerve. Over the next few slides, I'll be going through the origin of each nerve, their function, and where they enter or exit the cranial cavity. As you know, this video is part one of four videos. Therefore, I'll be discussing the first three cranial nerves in this video. First up, the olfactory. This nerve originates from the olfactory mucosa, found in the upper nasal cavity shown here. It then projects into the cranial cavity via the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone, directly to the olfactory bulb. These nerve fibers then form the olfactory tract and travel to the olfactory cortex. The olfactory nerve is purely sensory. Therefore, it interprets odor particles detected in the nasal cavity. In other words, undertake olfaction. Simply said, smell. As promised, in this video, I would be providing sample exam questions to help you study. So, question one, label the cribriform plate on this transverse image of the cranial cavity. Here it is. Next up, cranial nerve 2, the optic nerve. This nerve starts in the eye and exits at the optic disc, in particular, the blind spot. It then travels through the optic canal and crosses over with the optic nerve from the other eye to form the optic chiasm. From the chiasm, the nerve continues as the optic tract to the lateral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus. The thalamus redirects the sensory information to other parts of the brain. One path followed is to the primary visual cortex of the occipital lobe via nerves of the optic radiation. Just a note, this diagram of the brain is the inferior view. Therefore, the left and right sides are swapped. To understand the orientation better, pretend we've grabbed the brain out of the skull and flipped it upside down. In context of the cranial cavity, the optic nerve enters the cranial cavity via the optic foramen. The optic nerve is sensory. Therefore, when light stimuli hit the eye's photoreceptors, i.e., cones and rods, the optic nerve conveys this information to the brain for the formation of vision. Question 2. On this diagram, trace the pathway from the right eye to the primary visual cortex. You should have something similar like this. Question 3. The primary visual cortex of the left hemisphere receives sensory information from which fields of vision? Take a moment to study this image. If you said right field of vision of both eyes, then you're correct. An easy way to remember this is that the visual cortex receives contralateral information. Let's move on to cranial nerve number 3, the oculomotor nerve. The nerve originates from the midbrain region of the brainstem, but to be more precise, the oculomotor nucleus. There are a few pathways this nerve follows, but one of interest is where it follows the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus and exits the superior orbital fissure of the cranial cavity. If you look at this anterior view of the skull within the eye socket, this gap here is a superior orbital fissure. Moving on to the function. After exiting the cranial cavity, the nerve branches into the superior and inferior branch. The superior branch innervates the muscles here, superior rectus and levator palpebrae superioris, whereas the inferior branch innervates the inferior rectus, medial rectus, and inferior oblique muscles, as well as ciliary muscles and sphincter pupillae. Overall, the oculomotor nerve enables ocular movements such as elevating, depressing, and laterally moving the eyeball, opening and closing the upper eyelid, constriction of pupils, and reshaping of lens to accommodate for short or long range vision. Exam time. What are some symptoms of oculomotor nerve failure? Although I haven't discussed this, but it's a fairly logical one. Try and think back to the functions. Some symptoms can include ptosis, which is a droopy eyelid, non-reactive pupil, and an abnormal gaze, particularly outwards or downwards. Thank you for watching part 1. Stay tuned for part 2. Remember to hit subscribe and the like button for more great content. Come on, what are you waiting for?